So the last talk will be given by Elisabeth Romero from Amsterdam, and she will talk about two different chart separation pathways in System 2.
Thank you. I would like first to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to present this work here. And as you see the title, I will not be talking about life harvesting, but chart separation of the System 2. First of all, I would like to show you where the system is. Our system of studies, Photosystem 2, the isolated photosystem to reaction center, that is found in the higher plants, algae and cyanobacteria. And here we have the chloroplast, system of membranes. Photosystem 2 is mainly on the stack membrane. So if we take a electron micrograph image, we have the electron density map, and we can see this is the reaction center and is surrounded by many different antenna complexes. Okay, I would like to say why we study charge separation. This is because the success of photosynthesis depends on the efficiency of charge separation, and charge separation is one of the key steps in solar energy, energy conversion in photosynthesis from solar energy to electrochemical energy. So here I show you the isolated photosystem to reaction center. That is a pigment protein complex embedded in the thylakoid membrane. And well, we used to show this, always these cofactors, but I hope I will be able to show you how important is the protein scaffolding this dynamics. So here we have the cofactors. It looks like quite a simple system, but it's actually very complex. So we have four chlorophyll molecules in the center, and two phosphatidines, and two peripheral chlorophylls. Okay, so after absorption of a photon, the excitation energy is converted into a stable charge-separated state. In this system, we only have this because in the isolation process we lost the quinons. So this is our final state that drives water splitting and ultimately powers the whole photosynthetic organism. Here I would like to show a comparison between the bacterial reaction center and the photosystem 2. And this is a very well-known system, where you can see that there are actually very they are very similar, but the very small structural changes make a huge effect on the energy and the, you can see the absorption spectrum. So the main differences on this central chlorophyll, this so-called special pair, that in bacterial RC is a strongly coupled dimer, which makes them as the lowest energy state always in the system. However, it was 10 years ago, it was shown in our group that upon selective excitation of bacterial chlorophyll BL here, charge separation could occur via different pathway without passing through the special pair. So if we now look to this photosystem 2 reaction center, we see that the small difference in distance, but more on the overlap on these two chlorophylls. This the similar distance between the cofactors here gives rise a strong system of coupled pigments which interact and create a collective exciton states with participation from different different pigments. Okay, if you see, look at the absorption spectra, almost everything absorbs at the same wavelength. So here it's not possible to selectively excite any of the chlorophylls and follow the energy and charge separation pathways. So, but here if we take into account the fast protein interpigment vibrations and protein vibrations that we saw in the first topic, this nice movie, we could, taking into account the disorder that is the order of the coupling among the pigments, we propose that depending on the realization of the disorder, different lowest exciton states can exist. So the The protein defines which is the lowest excited state in the protein. So in the reaction center ensemble, we will have different reaction centers that are energetically different due to these very small changes in the protein configuration. So this idea of the two charge separation pathways comes also from a theoretical model proposed by Vladimir Novodevsky and Rink. Which this model, I will go fast, it's able to describe simultaneously, this is very important, simultaneously all kind of spectroscopic data, Truman, Cherry-K. So absorption fluorescence, linear and circular dichroism, triplet minus singleton kind of spectroscopy. And this is the excitonic manifold. This is quite complicated. So our experiment, we want to select from the homogeneous distribution subpopulations that will contain different contributions from the different pathways. In order to do that, we need to perform experiments at Stasinac and probe experiments at 77K in order to photoselect from the homogeneous distribution. Then, well, I would like to say first also that it has been for a very long time accepted in the literature that in the reaction center, this chlorophyll, chlorophyll D1, is the lowest energy state, and that charge separation will always start from this, this cofactor. I hope I will show you, I will convince you that this is not the case. So here you can see the absorption spectra of the reaction center, and this is the difference spectra of the final state, the charge separated state. So we can see here the 680 bridge, that is the bridge of the pheophytin, the QY of the pheophytin, and this shows that 672 PD1. And then the most important part here is that we can, because we probe simultaneously the whole visible range, and we can also monitor the pheophytin QX band. It's very small, but still it contains a lot of information because it's isolated, spectrally isolated from the rest. And it's important to know that this bridge will appear when pheophytin is excited or when, and also when pheophytin is in the reduced state. And then we have a second check, that is the pheophytin anion band that always only appears when the pheophytin is in the reduced state. So we can distinguish between excited and charge separated states. Okay, we use also other broader excitations. And in order to follow the spectral evolution, we perform a global analysis with a sequential model in which one compartment decays in the next one. And here I show you the different excitation wavelengths. So this is the excitation at 660. This is the laser profile, 665, 70, 75, 80, 85. So I would like to go fast on this and show you that when we excite the 660, we have in the first 500 femtosecond very fast exciton relaxation to lower levels. And before going into detail, I would like to say that this spectral evolution, that is what is usually taking into account in all the studies on this complex, this evolution is completely in agreement with the generally accepted pathway starting from chlorophyll D1, that gives rise to the first radical pair chlorophyll D1 for finding D1 minus and the final radical pair. However, if we look into the pheophytin QX and anion bands, we see, okay, I would like to say something here. In this case, after 1 to 3 picoseconds, that is this excitation energy transfer, we should, I mean, the population of pheophytin minus should remain constant because the following steps doesn't change the pheophytin minus. However, if we look at the isolated pheophytin QX and the anion band, we can see also, again, we are from 660 to 685 nanometers excitation. We can see that we have very different phases of pheophytin formation. So, just by looking to the data, we can say that the previously proposed charge separation scheme doesn't explain the whole dynamics. So we need an additional pathway which could start from PD-1, PD-2, and Cro-51, and that this is lower in the formation of pheophyte in minors. So so there is another step that we cannot resolve here, that is the radical pair among PD-1 and PD-2, that where we have here PD-1 plus Cro-51 minus, and then the electron is transferred to form the final radical pair. So I would like to stress here that I know that most of the people here like a lot of models. I also like models, but this is the data, just only looking to the data, this is almost raw data. You can see that you need an additional pathway to explain the dynamics. So what we do, the next step, is to perform a target analysis according to a kinetic scheme in order to resolve these two pathways that have very similar, but still some differences, so we can distinguish between them. We need to link six data sets. So here we have the normal, the generally accepted pathway and the additional pathway that come together to the same final state. So this is a chlorophyll set. This very filial chlorophylls that is known for a long time that they are absorbing at 670. And they transfer excitation to the 3 picosecond standard scale. Then if we look to these two states, we see that in the QY there is not much difference. Well, we have more stimulated emission from the excited state as expected. And if we look to this important part, we see that for the excited state, we have pheophyte in pitch, but we don't have anion band, which indicates that this is excited state, not radical pair. And in the radical pair, we have a bleach in the pheophyton and also the anion band. Then the next, the additional pathway we found, we can see that doesn't contain pheophyton at all. And then we see the two exciton, the lowest exciton and the highest exciton levels of pheophyton, PD-1 and PD-2, and a little bit of contribution from Cro-51, absorbing at 680. And well, this is the final state that is very, also really well known in the literature. So this target analysis is also able to give an estimation of the relative amount of pathways depending on excitation wavelength. Here we only use the blue excitations because when we go to red, we have because we are photoselecting from the homogeneous distribution, the final state is redshifted with respect to this other excitation, so we cannot use it together. But anyway, we see the amount of going from blue to red, the amount of chlorophyll D1 path increases, and the amount of PD1, we call it PD1 path, decreases. Then when we go to more red excitations, we are exciting also directly this charged transfer state that is not, we cannot resolve in the target analysis, but is in the model of Vladimir. Then we go again to higher proportion of this pathway. And then as a summary, I would like to show these pictures of the absorption of a photon, and depending on the excitation wavelength, we have a different proportion of reaction centers following one or the other pathway. So the excitation on average is distributed in the reaction center, so part of the excitation energy is located in these two cofactors, and in other reaction centers, depending on protein configuration, we will have the lowest excitable state will be located here. Then in the first picoseconds, we will have the first radical pairs. In 20 picoseconds, we have energy transfer from chlorophyll set to the reaction center. And in the tens of picoseconds, we get the final radical pair. So I would like also to show you the modeling of this data done by Vladimir Novodereskin. Very fast, I would like to show this model contains exactly the state manifold, which contains the six pigments and the four radical pairs. So modified field theories use two model the equilibration within the six core pigments, and this strongly coupled exacerbated the state that said we were not able to see the target. Then we use generalized Foster's theory to model the transfer from these excited states to the first radical pairs, and the standard Marcus Foster's theory formula for the final electron transfer. And then I would like to show you three representative traces. If we only take into account one pathway, we see the fit is not very good. So this is too slow to follow this and too fast for this. So we need, when we switch on the second pathway, the fitting is much better, even in agreement with the experiment. So the conclusions are that the two charge separation pathways are operational in the photosystem II reaction center. And the most important thing is that the election of a determinate pathway depends on the protein. So actually the protein is the one that decides what is the path that has to be taken. However, of course, this highlights the role of the protein in fine-tuning the reaction pathways. That is, have been seen more and more in the experiments that the protein has a very important role in the dynamics of the systems. Then at this point a question arises, that is the protein actively involved in deciding which pathway has to be taken, or is this just due to random disorder? Well, we cannot answer this question, but we can say that in case the protein will be actively involved, it will be that the protein is able to switch between states, which will create functional flexibility. This has been shown in life harvesting complex tools for plants, so that the system can switch between a protective state or a light absorbing state. And in case of random disorder, this would help in the maintenance of a quite high quantum yield of charge separation, despite the large disorder induced by the protein at room temperature. And we'd like to our future plans. This is still not done. Just I made a cartoon on this. So here we'd like to study the charge separation process. This is again the model lexicronic manifold. So we expect. So I put here. I draw here the most important. State. So this green is this exciton state, chlorophyll 1 for fighting the minus, for fighting, sorry, superradial state that is here. And then we have this other exciton state that we think is located here. It's strongly coupled with the first radical pair, PD1 minus PD2 plus. So we expect in a very fast time scale to see coupling between these two states, maybe some fluctuations. And then here we would like to be able to switch, because in any case, although we can, in this very nice technique, we are able to eliminate the inhomogeneous broadening. Let's say that we can see couplings of diagonal peaks. Anyway, we will be in any case exciting both pathways. So what we want to do is to, by using, because the orientation of these two of the transition dipole moment of the two lowest exciton states are different. So by using polarized light, we would like to switch on and off one of the pathways to be able to just look one of the pathways, and then maybe also use some special shaped passes. And we are open to suggestions if anyone has any idea how to do this with high efficiency. Of course, we know it's very difficult to only select one pathway, but at least to be able to tune the proportion of both. And then, this will teach us about design principles that are used in photosynthesis in order to. To design efficient systems that will be efficient in the energy conversion from the energy from the sun. That is our biggest source of energy. And I would like to acknowledge Ivo van Stockholm from Amsterdam, Vladimir Novodresky, Jan Decker and Rim van Grondella, and financial support from Marie Curie Actions through the ITRO2 program. And thank you for your attention.
My question is related to competition with energy relaxation or energy transfer. So it means that your charge separation 1 picosecond should be faster than energy relaxation, is it so?
Yeah, well, the thing is that here we use the low temperature to minimize this back transfer. Of course, at room temperature, you have competition between energy separation.
So this is low temperature.
This is 37 K, yes. Otherwise, this is to be able to photoselect from the continuous distribution and to make our life easier. Higher spectral resolution also. It's quite important when we are looking to such a small changes in the absorption spectra.
More question?
Yeah, maybe just to try to understand it better. So, as far as I got it, you have two different pathways when depending on your excitation wavelengths. Is it correct? Or
no.
It's not. So
no.
I missed it. Okay. What does it depend on what pathway to take? So
the broadband conformation.
But why does it change?
Because of disorder present in the system. So you have when you see all this nice crystal structure, this is just a picture, a snapshot.
So the ordering of your excitonic states changes because of disorder, and that's why it goes differently.
Yeah, all these excitonic states are average over disorder.
Okay.
So what you have is in every single complex.
Yes.
Because this is a coupled system. And the coupling is very similar to the disorder.
Yes.
A very small change in the protein,
yes,
will make that the lowest excitonic state in this specific complex will be located in two chlorophylls on another two. And this is what.
So this is the coupling that changes between the local chlorophyll and the protein.
Yeah, the protein itself decides.
Okay.
Which is the lowest energy state,
mm-hmm,
which defines the charge separation pathway,
mm-hmm,
because it's starting point.
So I think everybody is now ready for lunch.
Just a quick question: does that then, if it can switch between those two, is that an adaptive mechanism then? I mean, is it saying that basically, if you lock on the one pathway, maybe that's not as good because as the things are fluctuating, you wouldn't always be able to go as effectively through that pathway. I mean, is there an adaptive aspect to being able to switch between the two?
Yeah, well, we cannot, with the data we cannot say, but yeah, we think that this could be in the case for whatever stress conditions,
yeah,
in vivo,
yeah,
that will destroy the conditions for one pathway.
Yeah.
The other one to take over.
Right, right. So, yeah, provide sort of redundancy to the system that might be effective.
Yeah.
Okay, so I think we go for lunch, and before that we thank